Hi, everyone, and welcome to our Exploring English Language and Culture Facebook Live. I'm joined by Sally and Chris today. Hello.
Hi, everyone.
And we're here today to talk about one of the topics on our online course, Exploring English Language and Culture. And the topic we're here to talk about today is music, something that I'm sure many of you have lots to say about and are really interested in. I can see people joining us already. So, Sally, Chris, let's begin with you, Chris. I just mentioned that music is one of the topics that we look at on our Exploring English course. Can you say a little bit about the course and about what we talk about music on it?
About music? Well, it's a great week. It's one of my two favorite weeks on the course. Mm-hmm. And we first of all, we start by asking you to tell us about what British music means to you. It's always really interesting to hear what people around the world think about British music. So lots of people telling us how much they like the Beatles, Queen are really popular, Adele. So we ask you about your thoughts about British music, and then we ask you to tell us something about the music that you love from your own country. So we get loads of great recommendations from around the world. We ask, and we can make a playlist with that where we share people's songs. We ask people to tell us about protest music from their country. We look at a project in Southampton that uses music to help young people and helps young people make their own music. It's a really great week of the course.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned playlists, and maybe Tina, who's reading through the questions and answering some of those there, we actually have a few playlists from students on this course from before on our YouTube channel, and maybe we could share a link to some of them. And like you say, you get songs from, I think, not every country in the world, but I think we had more than 110 different countries, so quite a lot, I think, within that. Sally, is it one of your favourite weeks too?
They're all my favourite week, Neil.
Good answer. But, what I should have said.
But it is one of my favourite weeks. But they are, I mean, it's, I just love this course. It's actually one of my favourite courses.
Mm. Okay. Well, for the people who are watching, basically, we would like you to ask us any questions that you have, any questions you want to ask about music, about using music to learn English, about the course, about or tell us as well stuff about your favorite singers, bands, everything like that. We have people joining us, lots of people joining us already, from Nepal, from China, from Dubai, Albania, where else? Egypt, Paraguay, and lots more. Okay, and there's some questions coming already, so that's great. Let's begin with a question that I think someone has already mentioned, from Meru Dutta. We're talking about music. How useful is it? How can we use English songs as a tool for learning language to help our English? Who would like to begin this one? Sally.
Well, I think this is a, is this a question from a teacher, do we think?
It's hard to say.
Okay, but I think one of the great things about using music as a tool for learning languages is that it can be really, really motivating. Hmm. So I think if you're learning a language, it's great to do something that you enjoy doing in that language. So if you really like music, then it's really going to help you learn a language. There's lots of things. I'm thinking about what I do in class with my students, and one of the things that I do is I get them to bring in songs that they like, and then we play the song in class. A really basic thing that you can do if you are a teacher is to do a gap fill with the words of the song, and then play the song and the students fill it in, which that's the super basic thing that you can do. You can also use the song, or use songs for other things, use it as the basis for a lesson to talk about the characters in the song, for example, or how the music makes you feel. Have I run out of ideas already? Help me out.
We've run out of guests. Chris has disappeared.
I was talking too long. He's gone.
But no, as you say, I mean, I think the great thing is that you can do so much with it. There's vocabulary, like you mentioned, gap fill, singing along, pronunciation, stress, and you mentioned about how it makes you feel as well. I mean, that's, you know, because Everyone, no matter how old they are, you know, music affects them in some way, so they can talk about that and discuss it. And there's lots more. Chris, anything you'd like to add to that about the using English songs as a tool for learning a language? What can we do with them?
No, I agreed with everything that Sally said. I like using songs as stories. Maybe you mentioned that while I was in, when I disappeared.
Just in passing.
Lots of songs with a great story, and it's a really good way to, you know, your students can then tell the rest of the story or write things from the different characters' points of view. So I really like songs with stories. But have we mentioned pronunciation as well yet? Because that's another great thing.
Only in passing, yes. So
another great thing that we can do with songs, you know, we do it on the course. We ask people to sing a song, and we say how useful singing can be to help with your pronunciation and intonation, stress, and all of those things. Singing can really help with that. Although I wouldn't ask my students to sing always.
But I think
on the course we it's not obligatory, is it? It's we ask people if they want to. And the song.
And that's fantastic. So yeah, on the course people we ask people to sing a song and record it and share it with other students, and we've had some fantastic things there.
Mm-hmm. And some people are just commenting on this. Claudia Pacheco saying, "I love music to teach English through." So Claudia, tell us in the comments how you use music and maybe share it with some of the other people watching. What are some of the things that you do with music that really helps for that?
We can probably link to some activities from the Teaching English website as well. Yeah, I'm sure that lots. I know that there are some things there, yeah.
And here's
Sil Munoz in the comments mentioning Eleanor Rigby by the Beatles as a song with a story. That's you know, there are lots of really nice things in that song that are a starting point for students to write more about.
Mm. Yeah. And Sujud Musa Al Sheikh's just saying, "I prefer to listen to British music to get a good vibe." So maybe not the British music I listen to, but that's another story. okay. Max Moreno Sanchez is asking, "What pieces of music would you recommend for beginner students?" And this is a good point. I mean, obviously for beginners, there are lots, we have so much music to choose from even just, you know, pop music from the 1960s until 2021. Yeah. But I guess, well, you know.
So I've said this before about this, but this is why the Beatles were so great, because the Beatles wrote some songs for elementary learners, like Hello, Goodbye, and then they wrote songs for more advanced learners. You know, so Hello, Goodbye is A1 and Strawberry Fields Forever is B2.
Yeah, and I think even any, you know, whatever simple songs, you know, that deal with simple language, like, you know, repeated. I mean, it's great for that. Just the repetition is the thing about, you know, songs that are great. It's not boring to repeat something in a song.
Yeah,
It can be really boring to repeat it in a drill, you know, in a class again and again.
And I think it doesn't necessarily have to be easy, does it? You can choose something that where you can hear the words, you know, and that you can sing along to. And even if you don't understand all the words, you're getting a feel for English. You really are.
But that's the motivation that you talked about earlier. You know, I know when I listen to songs in other languages, that if you really like the song, or at least for me, then I want to know what the song is about. I want to know.
Yeah.
Have you ever had that thing where you listen to a song in another language and you think you know what the story is, and then you see the lyrics written down and you think, oh, it's completely different from what I imagined it was?
Yeah, quite a few times. Okay, lots of people making some really good comments here. Asu Kasem saying, "Listening to music helps me to practice my English, listen well, and then speak well." And absolutely, you know, that's it. Listening to music, the more you listen, it will help you when you come to speaking. Maria Souza saying, "In Portugal, we have a conference today about the influence of the Beatles promoted by one of Lisbon's leading universities."
Wow.
Excellent.
Now, this is a good question that comes up sometimes from B. Ewa Roma. I've heard that learning English by listening to a song is not a good idea because of mistakes. Now, I know my feelings on this, and I'll tell you them in a moment. What do you think?
Well, shall I start?
You were going to.
Okay, one thing that I do get from students sometimes is that they write in an essay, sometimes they'll write things like gonna and wanna, because they've got that from a song. Mm. But for me, that's super easy to correct.
Yeah.
You know? And it also means that they pronounce the word really well, because that's how they've heard it in the song and that's how it sounds. Mm-hmm. So I would say that the benefits massively outweigh any possible disadvantage. But as a teacher or as a learner, you need to be just aware that it's a different register.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's absolutely what I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree completely. And I would add to that that, you know, we know that not all speakers of English native speakers of English get everything right grammatically. It doesn't always match the grammar that you were taught at school. But that's not only in songs, that's in speaking and everything. So there might be mistakes in songs, but that's the language that people use.
Yeah. And as Sally said, the benefits outweigh the advantages.
Absolutely, yeah.
I mean, in songs are not always grammatical, because, you know, the person writing the song wants to fit the words into the melody and into the line. And sometimes you have to miss out, you know, an auxiliary verb or something to make it fit in there or stretch out a word. But it doesn't matter, because if you're learning that, using it, singing along, as Sally says, and both of you said, it's all about being aware. If you know that it's different, it's a good thing. Even then you can look at it and go, well, I understand why it's different and I understand what the difference is. My answer to Beatty Waroma would be absolutely don't worry about the mistakes, but concentrate on the good part.
Can I add one thing I've noticed as well, that sometimes the words in songs, it's not about mistakes, but sometimes the words aren't always really appropriate for everyday conversation. You know, if you're listening to some rap music.
You've been listening to the new Doja Cat single, haven't you? Yes.
I mean, you might have to point that out to students, for example, if you are a teacher, or, mm-hmm. you know, if you're listening to words, be careful of the strength of words.
Yeah. No, you're right. I mean, yeah. And again, the different types of music and different eras or different times of music are quite different for that. But yeah, there's a lot of songs, I think more now possibly than ever before, where the lyrics are not appropriate for everyday use.
That's why we always use the Beatles in class.
Speak for yourself.
As you say, that's true of films, it's true of books, it's true of everywhere that you get. Mm-hmm. You know, as we always say, there's never been a better time for being able to find real English spoken by real people in real places. That, you know, that's what the internet is for. You have all of that. And with everything, you have to be careful that you have the right context and you don't use the wrong things in the wrong places. So it's true of songs in the same way as it's true of everything.
Yeah. And, I mean, Seal Munoz, again, has made a very good point there. You can encourage critical thinking if you choose the correct song. That also goes for things like appropriacy or, you know, gender or lots of things like that you could look at in songs and then actually examine and talk about. So such a rich resource with so many different possible things.
Yeah.
Nestle Hans saying the same thing as you were saying earlier, Sally, fill in the blanks while listening to music and students really like it.
We'll get the students to do it.
Maria's saying everything is easier through music. Sentence construction, poem analysis, to notice things like rhyme and so on, forced rhyme. Lots of good comments coming in here. That's great. Keep them coming. Sahar is saying music and songs help me to increase my vocabulary as well as pronunciation. I think the pronunciation was a good one to just think about as well, because often, I'm very shy of my pronunciation when I'm not speaking in English. And to be honest, sometimes when I'm speaking in English. But, you know, when you're singing, you know, if you're singing in the shower or something, or just at home while you're doing something, you're not shy. You're not worried about what you're kind of doing then. What do you think? I mean, do you think it's a good way to kind of overcome shyness with pronunciation and maybe practice that? Or am I just making
Well, money? I don't think me singing is a good way to overcome anything. But
a crowded room, perhaps.
But yeah, I agree that singing something is different from speaking it, and it can help you in lots of ways. Mm-hmm. And not just the pronunciation of individual sound; it's more the sentence level, which I think sometimes students and teachers forget about practicing that pronunciation at that level, and that's where singing can really help.
Mm-hmm. Chitso Aung is saying, could you turn on British music, sir? We want to listen to it. I would love to, but because of copyright and Facebook, we can't actually play music during our Facebook Live, which is unfortunate for a Facebook Live about music. But we do have lots of music you can listen to. The British Council have their own radio station, which I share every week on the Facebook channel here, Selector Radio, and you can listen to lots of British music there. And we also have some songs on our, we have songs for kids on Learn English Kids and nursery rhymes. And then we have, pop rock songs on Learn English Teens with some activities there that you can listen to as well. So there are some there. Okay. Let's take another question. Kind of follows on from that a little, I guess, from Sudhakar Sundara Katare, who's saying, is there any app to listen to British music, and is it understandable? Good question. So are there ways that people can actually focus on language with music using apps or websites?
Well, I've seen somebody mention lyrics training already in the comments. Lyrics training is a good way to see the lyrics of the song and practice and sing along.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
For anyone who doesn't know lyrics training, it has all the latest, you know, basically as soon as a song comes out, they have it up there, as well as, you know, lots of old songs going all the way back to the Beatles and Rolling Stones and everything else. And you can listen to it and sing along just like karaoke, or you can listen to it with the gap fill and try as you listen to complete the lyrics. And it's great for everything, for listening and for vocabulary and for your typing skills as well. And any others that you can think of, or any other ways that people can kind of get music or use music from, you know, apps or websites or things?
As learning resources.
Yeah.
I mean, you mentioned the selector, and I think, Tina's just added a link to the selector in the comments, which is a magazine radio program.
And I think, did you mention Learn English Kids songs?
Only a little. You can say more.
Okay, so the Learn English Kids, there's loads and loads of really, really good songs, some really, really catchy tunes, and there's activities that go with them. I mean, they're for children, but they're great if you've got kids. Maybe you want to, you could use them with your children, but you don't have to be a child to enjoy those songs, really. You know, somebody was asking about songs for beginners. With people with beginner level of English, and I think they're great. You know, everybody loves a good song, even if it's designed for children.
Yeah, I was going to say, because we have the new series on Learning with Kids, the robot songs as well, that are more kind of more current pop music kind of things like that, but also just really good, you know, instructions and things to do and routines and things like that that are quite fun and good for language. Okay, here's one for Chris. From Sujud Musa Al-Sheikh. Do British singers use music and songs to reflect social issues or just to talk about love? This is on the course, isn't it? So it's like,
there's nothing wrong with talking about love. You know, everyone likes a love song. But I think like everywhere, there are lots of British singers talking about social issues and things that aren't about love. Just before we started broadcasting, we were talking about Sleaford Mods. They're a very angry vocal group talking about social issues. On the course, this is one of my favorite parts of one of my favorite courses, is where we talk about protest songs. So protest songs are where singers sing about social issues and try and make a change. And we ask you to share your protest songs with us from around the world, and we've had some fantastic things. I've spent hours following YouTube links to protest songs from around the world. So there's lots of this stuff now. I mean, we could name some examples, or Tina can add some to the comments.
Yeah. And especially in a lot of kind of rap things, there's lots of stuff like that, like Dave and things really good, good lyrics and really interesting, you know, really this well-written, beautiful use of vocabulary and, you know, lots to learn in them. So lots of stuff there. So yes, more than just love, but there's nothing wrong with love is the conclusion there. Okay. Okay, hold on. How to make English I'm speaking.
Just on that theme, my brother sent me a link, a Spotify link to a Billy Bragg song the other week, who is quite political in his his songs. Can't remember which one it was, because after that, Spotify just played me Billy Bragg.
Billy Bragg has love songs as well.
And I'm going to bring Seal Munoz up again because there's so many good comments about this. But I would say that there aren't mistakes in language. Language is a living thing, always changing and accommodating. We have to be aware that we should teach real English. I think that's absolutely true. And the thing about music is that it is very, very current and contemporary now, and changes. You know, I grew up in Scotland. You know, at a time when we didn't have the internet and didn't have all of the information. And for me, lots of things, lots of new expressions, vocabulary, I learned them from songs that, you know, people were saying them in other parts of the country. I had no idea what they were talking about. But that was my first kind of exposure to it. Herbert, what do you think, Chris?
Well, I think this is, again, I keep saying it, but this is not just about music. It's about everything. If you're a learner of English now, then you have so many opportunities to get so much real English. And so, when we start talking about mistakes in English, then, no, I've got myself into trouble about this before, about the British Council can't say that if everybody says it, it's not a mistake. But
it kind of is.
Okay. It's all about communication, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mistakes are included in communication.
Yeah, and you mentioned earlier, Sally, you were talking about register and just understanding the difference, you know, when it's appropriate for stuff like that. And exactly, it's all about communication and who you're communicating with. I mean, you know, you wouldn't necessarily go into a job interview and use the same language as you would use it in your, you know, your latest rap song.
But depends on the job.
Yeah,
you might be going for an interview as a rap artist.
Yes, or with the British Council social media team, in which case you would get the job immediately. Okay, I'm just looking through. There's so many good comments there. I'm just scrolling through them to look for some to choose. Okay, this is a nice one from Marigold Daffodil, who's saying, "Hello from Lebanon. Singing helps pupils gain confidence, especially the mime and movement, to overcome their language troubles." I think that's a great point as well, isn't it? I mean, you know, the physical movement when you're doing stuff means you're not worrying about what you're saying or if you're making mistakes.
Yeah. I definitely do. Yeah, head, shoulders, knees and toes. Yeah. But I definitely, when I'm teaching younger learners, definitely all songs have actions, and the actions help you remember the words. And it's just great that it's the whole body's involved, and as well as the brain. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just a couple. Now this is an interesting one. With our combined experience of so many years, we probably can answer this now. But Emma Smith's just saying, "I'm new to teaching English, and what I need are some catchy grammar songs to help me to learn it." That's a good point. Some songs are excellent for focusing on grammar. You mentioned story songs earlier, Chris. I mean, sometimes that can be a really good one.
It depends. A grammar song. Another thing I think which we haven't mentioned is the danger of killing a song by, you know what I mean?
Playing it 45 times to focus on the use of the past perfect tense in verse 3.
and one piece of advice that I got as a teacher when I started was never use a song that you really in class. Never use a song that you really love, because that's a certain way to kill the song for yourself, and the students won't love it as much as you love it, and it will just make everybody unhappy.
I think a lot of that just comes down to how you plan a lesson as well, though, doesn't it? Because, I mean, I mean, you can choose a song that has, I mean, for example, just routines, present simple, you know, I get up, I go out, whatever, all stuff like that. Or you can choose one that has a story. And, yeah, you could easily, like you say, kill that song if you milked it to death. But
I think it's good to, if you whatever you're doing with the song in class, then you can have a look at the language in that song. And rather than the other way around, perhaps choosing a song because of the specific grammar point. Although I can see on my bookshelf here, I've got a book called Singing Grammar that I haven't used for years, but it's got grammar.
But, you know, to be fair, at the same time, I think Beyoncé did more for the correct use of the subjunctive than I think every English teacher in the history of the world has ever done. if I were a boy, you know, I mean, you know, she cured that mistake or that problem with one song that's been teachers have been spending years on.
Well, actually, this is another. I'm thinking of things from years ago when. Asking students to write new verses of songs. If you get some songs with a very clear pattern, then it's not difficult for students to add their own bits to the song. So rather than listening to the song again and again, I can't think of an example off the top of my head, but if you get a song with a very clear pattern, then don't listen to it again and again, but ask the students to add their own to it.
Yeah,
do you remember that Suzanne Vega song, Dinah?
Exactly, that's one that everybody used. Yeah. Because it's a really clear rhythm.
Yeah. But you know what? When I was first teaching as well, and just learning more about grammar, I kind of found that useful as well for myself, looking at the grammar in songs.
Yeah.
But Emma, you probably know more about grammar than I did.
Okay, I'm just going to pop this up. I can't answer this one just now because it's a really good question from Estelle Framboise. I'm in France teaching to young adults and looking for songs on social issues. Not easy. Thanks for any help. I think I can help with this, and I think I do have some really good examples. But you know, it would take too long to go into them just now and kind of work with that. But we'll add some links into that later. We've mentioned some people already that have some, you know, really good songs on these things and some good examples and different styles. So you can, you know, choose the one that fits most with the kind of music your students might enjoy. But there's definitely ones that can help with that. Okay. Noor Jamak is saying, fantastic and fascinating to select songs for only learning purposes, but what if it distracts me towards being a singer and a career change? I would say, go for it.
With the flow.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. And just lots of, we've got lots of teachers in today all confirming this. So, I mean, for any of you who are students who are learners that you know perhaps haven't used songs so much yet, we have many students today all saying what a great thing it is. So definitely give it a try. I think we have to finish in a couple of minutes, so I'll just look for a couple more questions. Bear with me. If either of you have seen any that jumped out at you.
No, I'm agreeing with what Saha is saying about translating songs is another way to kill the song.
I would say that to everyone, to learners and teachers, because songs, you know, songs and poems are incredibly difficult to translate and keep the meaning, even for translators, professional translators. You know, to do it well, people really actually have to be good at the poetry or literature aspect
So it's a good thing to do in class, but not in an English class, in a translator's class.
Heber's
asking, sorry, go on, Neil.
Tell me.
I was just going to say, Heber's asking about useful websites for using songs in grammar, and I was just thinking about that they're not songs, but they're chants on Learn English Kids. There are some grammar chants there. And they're just a nice way. They're lovely chants, and they do contain grammar if that's something you want to focus on. They focus on the grammar.
I'll need to look this out because I don't have it to hand, but I know on Teaching English there's something on this as well. And there's also a blog post that has been shared a few times on the Teaching English Facebook page that is exactly that. It's basically a website that does kind of, you know, identify which songs you could use for different things like that. But I don't have the address to hand for that. Okay.
I like that question by Mari Nakashima? Asking about songs by non-native singers.
This is a really good question because it kind of ties in with another question we had, which was about why do British singers sing in an American accent? And, you know, some of the non-native singers and songwriters, they're some of the greatest songs ever written in English have been written by and written and sung by non-native singers and songwriters. So what would you say to Mari's question then? No, would be my first question.
Yeah, that's the short answer. No, I don't have any concerns about it. And in fact, I think even sometimes that a non-native ear or a non-native feel for the language makes things very interesting, or it brings an interesting new use of language that perhaps a native speaker wouldn't have imagined or wouldn't have invented. Mm-hmm. So it can be really interesting. And again, that's a reason why I like asking students to come up with song lyrics and things, because it gives students an extra bit of freedom. They don't feel that things have to be exactly right because it's a song, and we know that songs aren't always 100% correct. So it gives students that freedom to experiment and play with language a bit. And that can be really interesting, produce some really nice inventive results. Yeah.
And just talking about that, I immediately was thinking of like Björk, and you know, when I first listened to her when she was with the Sugar Cubes, when they sang in Icelandic and then sang in English, like you say, the words were, you know, they were not what you would expect. They were something, a different way of playing with the words or using the words because it was coming from that. And so I think there's a lot of positive things to say about that.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that will have to be our last question though, because we've run out of time. Just one comment from Janet here. I think it's very useful to learn music is very useful to learn English. I've been using music in my classes in order to improve my students' listening skills. I think the one thing everyone has said here today that I think everyone's agreed on is how useful music is, and you know, for me, how much fun it is and how enjoyable it is. So last messages from both of you. Tina first.
She's not Tina.
I think you mean Sally.
You know what I mean, Sally.
We're interchangeable. Yeah. Tina's our colleague who's on comments at the moment.
Yeah. In my mind, you've just become one kind of...
it's because we've got the same glasses. Anyway, my comment is just thank you for joining us today. It's fantastic to see all your questions. It's really interesting that we've had loads of teachers.
Yeah.
And also, just if you want to join our course, come and join us there and talk more about this topic.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. And Chris, final words.
My comment is, I've just remembered a Taylor Swift song where she makes a grammar mistake, and it really annoys me. And I've just changed all of my advice for the last 30 minutes. Taylor Swift gets the third conditional wrong. She says, "It would have been fun if you would have been the one."
It's very common in American English that if I would have, but
I don't care.
I know.
No, thank you all. It is really interesting to see all of your comments, and I hope that if you're a teacher, you will try it with your classes, and if you're a student, then you'll find some new music. Join the course. You'll find lots of recommendations from us and from other students of things to listen to that will help you when you're learning.
Mm-hmm. And as Sally mentioned, Tina shared some fantastic links in the comments to some of the websites we've been talking about, as well as one I had never heard of. She hasn't shared this one with me before, called Gnusic. You know that one?
No.
It's a new one for me, so I'll be checking that out after this.
Thanks, Tina.
Yep, thanks. Okay, thank you, everybody, for your great questions. It's been a lot of fun, and we'll see you again for the next one of these in a few weeks' time. Okay.